Hello, friend. Thank you for joining me. This is the second part of a message entitled Change Your Thoughts, Change Your World. And if you missed the first part, hey, you're going to get all you need out of today's message. So, you know, put your seatbelt on, put your safety helmet on, get your Bible, and let's get ready to get into the Word of God together. This truth that we're sharing is earth-changing. So get ready, get ready, get ready. Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you, He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers.
Previously on Answers with Bayless Conley.
All right, go out with joy from where? Be led out with peace from where? Well, think about what he said. He said, look, leave your thoughts, leave your ways outside and come to me. I have thoughts that are higher than your thoughts. I have ways that are higher than your ways. And if you will listen to me and embrace my word, you will go out from my presence with joy. You'll be led out of my presence with peace. Thought number one, that you are stuck. Stuck in your present circumstance, stuck in your present situation with no way out. I know there are some people here, you're just practically on the verge of giving up. Things are never going to change. I'm stuck. Saved, sanctified, and stuck. I'm stuck. Always been this way. It was this way for my family. It's this way for me. It's never going to change. I'm stuck. You got to be willing to get rid of that thought if you're going to embrace God's thoughts. And when you embrace His thoughts, my friend, His mercy can touch you. Somebody says, what's God's thought? Well, remember, this book is a revelation of His thoughts. Let me read it to you, 1 Corinthians 10 and 13. There is no trial has overtaken you that is not faced by others. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tried beyond what you're able to bear, but with the trial will also provide a way out so that you may be able to endure it. With the trial, everybody say with. With the trial, at the same time the trial is going on, God provides a way out.
Today on Answers with Bayless Conley.
All right, thought number two, that the enemy has the upper hand. Whether you're talking about your city, maybe the school board, that has told you they don't want you to investigate what your child's being taught and you don't have a say, or, you know, maybe the local council or maybe, you know, our state. I listen to some people talk about what's going on in our state, and, you know, there's a mass exodus, obviously, out of California. People say, I got to get out of here. I feel like I'm living in a police state right now. And I vehemently disagree with things that our state government has implemented. Personally, I vehemently disagree with a number of things. But listen, the devil's not in charge of California. The devil does not have the upper hand. Some people think, oh, the world is going to hell in a handbasket. Look at the devil is doing this and the devil is doing that. And oh man, the world is just on fire. Listen, there's a lot of wrong things going on in the world, but the devil is not in charge. The devil does not have the upper hand. Not in my personal life, not in my marriage, not in this world. I want to read to you a story from Numbers 13. You can go there if you want. The Israelites have come out of Egypt to the border of the promised land. The scripture tells us that they were the very generation God had prophesied to Abraham hundreds of years before. Which generation of his offspring would enter into the promised land. It was God's stated will that they were the ones that go in and enjoy the land of milk and honey. So they get to the border of Canaan's land, and Moses sends 12 spies in to spy out the land, one spy from each tribe. So they go in, check out the land, and they come back. And I want to pick it up in verse 30. Now, Caleb and Joshua, they were two of the spies. And in verse 30, Numbers 13, but Caleb tried to quiet the people as they stood before Moses. Let's go up at once to take the land, he said. We can certainly conquer it. But the other men who had explored the land with him disagreed. We can't go up against them. They're stronger than we are. So they spread this bad report about the land among the Israelites. The land we traveled through and explored will devour anyone who goes to live there. All the people we saw were huge. We even saw giants there, the descendants of Anak. Next to them, we felt like grasshoppers. And that's what they thought too. The Bible in basic English says, we seem to ourselves no more than insects. So we seemed to them. So we went. People are huge, there's walled cities, and they looked at us and they thought, just a bug to be squashed. The Israelites are nothing. So we felt like insects ourselves. That's exactly what they thought about us when they saw us. Now Joshua and Caleb saw things differently, and they spoke in faith and agreed with what God had said, because God said, every place the sole of your foot treads, I've given it to you. You're well able to take the land. They agreed with God, but the nation sided with the 10 spies. They listened to the report of the 10 spies, and for the next 40 years, Israel wandered in the wilderness. They did laps around Mount Sinai for 40 years. That generation from 20 years old and upward never entered into the promised land. They all died without experiencing the promise. So we fast forward 40 years into the future. Now Moses is dead and Joshua is taken over. They're gonna have a second run at it. They're gonna go in to the promised land 40 years later. And so Joshua, like Moses, sends spies in. He sends two. Joshua chapter 2 and verse 1. Now Joshua, the son of Nun, sent out two men from Acacia Grove to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, especially Jericho. So they went and came to the house of a harlot named Rahab and lodged there. Verse 8, now before they lay down, she came to them on the roof and said to the men, I know the Lord has given you the land, that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt 40 years ago. And what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed 40 years ago. And as soon as we heard these things, 40 years passed, our hearts melted, neither did there remain any more courage in anyone because of you. For the Lord your God is God in heaven above and on earth beneath. 10 spies came back 40 years earlier, said, man, we're grasshoppers, we're just insects, and they thought the same thing. But the truth was, when the Canaanites, the giants, and everyone of that generation saw them, they were shaken in their boots. Their hearts had melted, their courage had fled from them, they were terrified. Listen to me. One wrong thought kept them from their inheritance. One wrong thought. They believed a lie, and it kept them from ever experiencing the God-promised inheritance that was laid up for them. They never walked in it. They never tasted it because of their thinking. I often hear people talk as if the devil is bigger than God. especially when they look at the state of their nation over the last few years. You know, Isaiah also prophesied, said this in Isaiah 40, "Behold, the nations are as a drop in the bucket. They are counted as the small dust of the scales to God." Isaiah also said this in Isaiah 60, "Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people." We see that. But, everyone say, but. "But the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising." We will have revival in the church. We will have an awakening in the world, and King Jesus will reign. Our King will prevail. You know, in Luke 11, Jesus said, "I cast out demons by the finger of God." This is just like flicking a piece of lint off my lapel. This is no contest between titans. This is a contest between our God, who's a consuming fire, and a moth. A moth that is less than nothing. The devil does not have the upper hand. My friend, we are on the winning side. All right, third thought. You got to be willing to abandon this if you're going to embrace God's thoughts. That people do not want to hear the gospel. People don't want to hear. Whether you're thinking of your family, your neighbors, your friends, the world we live in. You know, Jesus said in John chapter 4, you say there's 4 months and then the harvest. You always say the harvest is going to be in the future. He said, but I say, lift up your eyes and look on the fields. They're already white and ready for harvest. Harvest is now. That's true in every generation. But the tendency of people is, well, you know, it's coming. It's coming. People want to hear now. I remember after I got saved, went over to a friend's apartment, and there was a bunch of them there. I knew everyone there. And they were doing this thing where you pray to angels, and then you mix these bags up in a stick. Sticks up in a bag. You mix up these special sticks, you throw them down, you ask a question to the angels, and then however the sticks land, the angels tell you what to do because they influence the sticks, and then they would go out and do whatever the sticks said. So I was there, and they were doing that thing with the sticks. And one of my friends, in fact, he was a very close friend, and I'm a brand new Christian. He says, "Bayless, you apparently don't like this, do you?" I said, "No, I don't." He says, "Don't you believe that angels influence the sticks?" I said, "Yeah, actually, I do. I just think they're bad angels." And then I shared Jesus with them, shared my testimony with them, and they began to howl with laughter. I literally left the apartment with them shrieking and laughing behind me, making fun of me, throwing taunts my way. A few weeks later, one of the girls that was there came to me and said, "Bayless, you know, the other day in the apartment, I know that had to be really hard for you, but I couldn't get away from what you said about Jesus, and I want you to know I've accepted him as my Lord and Savior. I've been reconnected with my family. I was estranged from them." You know what? I'm telling you, even in every pack, you know, of antagonists, there's someone there with a hungry heart. There always is. You know, I was preaching in a particular European nation, preaching from John chapter 4. Let's not just put the harvest off. People are hungry now. I was actually doing a pastor's summit. So it's all pastors in the meeting. And I got done, and one of the local pastors came up, and he rebuked me sharply. He said, "You're an outsider. You just don't know. This is not the time for harvest in our country. That's false. That's wrong." He said, "Now, it's a time for us to pray." I agree with that. We need to talk to God about men, but then I think we need to get out and talk to men about God afterwards. But I mean, he rebuked me sharply and told me basically I had no business being there, no business saying that. I didn't understand their nation. I didn't know the culture. I didn't know the atmosphere. He said, "It is not the time for harvest." Now, walking distance from there, we had actually rented out a venue, and I was going to hold an evangelistic meeting that night.
I said, listen, we've got a meeting. You can walk there from here tonight. We've invited people, encouraged them to invite their friends. Just come and see if God does anything. He said, no. And basically dismissed me. I got to the meeting that night, walking distance for where he and I had the conversation, very one-sided conversation, and the building was packed. There was standing room only. And when I gave the invitation, people came forward. There was standing room only in the front. It was several deep and all the way across the front. You know, maybe 20 people across, two or three people deep all the way, many of them tears rolling down their cheeks, accepting Christ and being saved for the very first time. I mean, we're talking within a quarter mile of where this guy said, no one's hungry. No one wants to hear. My friend, people are hungry. People do want to hear. In fact, not far from there, not far from that spot, there was a guy, he was a well-known tattoo artist in his country. If you wanted to get inked, 3-month wait to get in and get a tattoo. That's how many people were lined up because this guy's work was so good. But he was also a criminal. The police knew and had tried and tried to catch him, but he was too clever for them. He turns on the TV. There's a broadcast from Cottonwood on. He watches it, walks out in the snow, kneels down in the snow, and gives his life to Jesus. And then he comes back home, gets all of his weapons, got all this stash of illegal weapons, gets a boat, goes, there's a big lake right by where he lived, went out in the middle of the lake, threw all the weapons overboard, down to the bottom of the lake, calls us. Tells us what's happened. Got a hold of the office. I talked to him on the phone. He said, would you come hold a meeting in my tattoo parlor? I said, I'm in. So we come. He invited all his friends. Roughest looking bunch of people I've ever preached to. The tattoo parlor is filled with all of his clients and criminal friends. Every one of them got saved. And then we led everyone in a mass baptism in the Holy Spirit, like Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit fell, and here all these guys speaking in other tongues. This is right near where the guy said, people are not hungry. People don't want to hear. No, friend, people are hungry, and they do want to hear. Which brings us to the next thought that you need to abandon, and that is, God will not use you in a dynamic way. You've got to get rid of that thought that God won't use you. Listen, God's thoughts, 1 Corinthians, God has chosen the foolish things and the weak things and the despised things. You know, the things that the world says are unqualified to bring to nothing the things there are to confound the wise. God uses the unqualified. God's just looking for the available. You know, when I was in Bible school, I saw a couple there one day. And I could just tell from looking at them, I knew their background because I'd been there and done that. So I went up, introduced myself to them, and they were awkwardly shy. Awkward. And I said, hey, my name's Bayless. I want you guys, would you come to my little apartment? I said, it's not much. I got this old formica table that was dug out of the trash and a couple of old metal chairs, but would you come over to my apartment for lunch? I want to talk to you guys. So they came. I still remember we had grilled cheese sandwiches. Sitting around the table, I said, look, I know something about you. I said, well, how do you know? And I told them. I said, you guys come out of a drug background. I said, and you had a penchant for these kind of drugs. They said, yeah, how'd you know that? I said, same as me. I'd like the same hallucinogenic drugs that you did. And so we talked about our past and all the stuff that we've been involved in and became friends. And listen, again, these guys, they're new, brand new Christians. And they awkwardly shy and almost with fear and trepidation, are they taking steps forward in this life with Christ? Upon graduation, they went down on a short mission trip to a country. And God used them to reach the presidential family. They ended up holding Bible studies in the presidential palace. Got the president's wife filled with the Holy Spirit. had this little mini revival going on. When they're leaving the country, suddenly this motorcade comes, all these Jeeps and military vehicles come and stop the people getting on the plane and pull them out. They go, what's going on? What's going on? It was a local general there. He said, I heard what you've been doing at the presidential palace. The president's wife talked to me. I need what you have. I stopped you because I want you to pray for me. They laid hands on him on the tarmac and prayed for him, led him in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They're on the tarmac before they got on the plane. Now, just to give you an idea, when we're sitting around that formica table eating our grilled cheese sandwiches, they said, yeah, Bayless, we used, and I was talking about a particular drug, said, we used to do that drug, and we would go in the woods and take all of our clothes off and dance naked while we were high. So here are these guys, they're changing. We're talking about the woodland fairy dancers. They're the ones that God is using to impact a nation. There's a 12-year-old boy that came up to me in a park and told me about Jesus. First human being that ever shared the gospel with me. He was 12 years old. He was just a normal kid that loved Jesus. He wants to use you in a dynamic way. And you never know the rippling effect that your obedience can have. You never know. If Jesus tarries, it may change generations to come. You never know the dominoes that might fall from one act of obedience, from you just opening your mouth and sharing. You never know. I was golfing one day. There was an old man at the time. I thought he was old. I was in my 30s. He was probably 65, which is younger than I am now. But I thought, this guy's ancient. He doesn't have too long before he kicks the bucket. So I shared the gospel with him out on the golf course. I still remember it was on the 11th hole, Costa Mesa, playing Mesa Linda, that particular golf course. There's two tracks there, Los Lagos and Mesa Linda. We stopped on the 11th fairway. I said, you want to pray? He said, I do. And so this ancient guy and I held hands on the 11th fairway. And we prayed and he accepted Jesus. Never heard from him again, never seen him again. But you know what? Simple act of obedience like that, you have no idea. He may have led his kids and his grandkids to Christ. One of them may end up being an evangelist that changes a nation for God. You just never know what might happen. God wants to use you. Don't think, oh, no, my past, that cancels me out. I could never be used by God. I'm divorced. Listen to me. God can use you. In fact, a lot of my notes didn't think I'd say this. I don't know if you ever thought about it or not. God himself is a divorcee. According to some people, he's not qualified for ministry. He called Israel his bride to the point that he put them away and gave them a bill of divorce. You are not disqualified, my friend. Now, I'm not saying you live and walk any way that you want, but I'm telling you, God will use you. You're not disqualified. God will use you. And God knows you, and he loves you, knows everything about you, knows your past, knows everything you've done, everything you haven't done, and he loves you. And he sent his son Jesus to rescue you. You know, I was looking for God for a long time. People never would have suspected it if they would have examined my lifestyle, but it was. I just looked in all the wrong places. It wasn't until a 12-year-old boy came up to me in a park one day and told me Jesus Christ was alive that I ever really, honestly considered Christianity and the claims of Christ. I'd never heard the claims of Christ. I'd never read the Bible. There is one way into a relationship with God. It's through his son, Jesus Christ. It's not about rituals. It's not about ceremonies. It's not about God, you know, siphoning all of the fun out of your life and all the joy out of your life, and now you need to be this cookie cutter, you know, clone of a Christian. Now, God's created you unique, and you will really, truly never discover the core of who you are and your potential until you start walking with Jesus. Everything finds its proper place in Him. First and foremost, us. And He won't turn you away. It doesn't matter what you've done. It just doesn't matter. Jesus died on the cross to take away your sins. Think about it. He's born of a virgin, lives a sinless life, and then at about 30 years of age, enters into ministry. He talks like no one ever talked before. People hung on every word. He didn't talk about God being, you know, this angry being in the skies with a big stick just waiting for you to mess up so He could wallop you one. And He didn't talk of God as being some, you know, distant, uncaring, aloof being. But He spoke of Him as being a loving Father that was near and concerned for your life, concerned for the affairs of your life. And Jesus worked miracles. He healed the sick. He even raised the dead. He said, if you've seen Me, you've seen the Father. What I say, this is the Father talking. The things I do, that's a revelation of the Father's will. That's a revelation of His heart toward people. And you know, I love the fact that most of the Gospels, most of the record we have of Jesus' earthly life, if you read through the Gospels, the majority is taken up either Jesus' teachings or Him spending time with individuals. Stories with individuals. God loves the individual. He loves you.
It's true, my friend. You are not some faceless person in a massive crowd to God. You are not a number on an endless list on some computer in heaven. God knows you personally. He knows you intimately. King David said, God, You know when I sit down, You know when I rise up, You know my thoughts from afar. You know everything about me. He knows everything about you, and He loves you. He knows everything about me, and He loves me still. God wants to have a personal relationship with you. Jesus died so that you could come into a relationship with the Father. Jesus said, in that day you'll ask Me nothing. In the day of salvation, in the day when He's been raised from the dead, He said, in that day you'll ask Me nothing, but whatever you ask the Father, He'll give it to you. The purpose of Christ's death on the cross and resurrection was to bring salvation to us, which literally has to do with becoming a part of God's family and knowing God personally as Father, having a relationship with our Creator. My friend, He may be God to the flowers of the field. He may be God to the sparrow, but He's Father to me, and He wants to be Father to you. Maybe you've never had an earthly father that was good, but you have a heavenly Father that is good always. He's love, and He loves you.
What happens when you pray? Do your prayers come with answers? Or does it feel like God is silent? Your prayers can have an impact. You can hear God in prayer. In Bayless Conley's easy-to-read booklet, How to Pray, you'll learn how to have an effective, life-changing prayer life. Oftentimes, we simply skip over the step of inviting God into our lives through prayer. But God wants to connect with you. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com and get How to Pray, you'll discover that God desires to not just hear from you, but to speak to you. You'll understand that prayer is essential to live a victorious life and exactly how to make your prayer life a consistent and dynamic part of your relationship with God. Available in physical, digital, or audiobook formats for just $12. How to Pray will challenge you to focus on God, listen to what He is saying, and then yield to His desires for your life. When you go to BaylessConley.com and get How to Pray, you will learn the practical ways to deepen your relationship with God by using the simple framework of praise, repentance, asking, and yielding every time you pray. Your prayers can have an impact. You can hear from God in prayer. Go online right now to BaylessConley.com to get How to Pray. That's BaylessConley.com. Go online right now.
We're uploading new content every week to help you find answers for your life. So don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. In the comments, let us know how this teaching encouraged you. We'd love to hear from you. Our prayer is that God's richest and best be yours always.